Well, good morning, everyone. We're going to open with worship this morning. I feel like I probably need to introduce myself to those of you who do not recognize me, because I got a haircut this week. So, yeah. Long-haired hippie pastor is gone. So, welcome to worship this morning. If we were to ask one thing of the Lord, what would we ask of him this morning? What should we seek here this morning as we gather together? And he gives us, at least David gives us a direction to point our desires and our questions to him this morning. Psalm 27:4, one thing I have asked from the Lord, and that shall I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to meditate on his temple. So as we gather this morning, let's dwell on God's beauty and meditate on who he is as we gather this morning. So let's ask him to help us, because we really need his help in order to meet and to see him, because our eyesight isn't good enough to be able to see him. So let's ask. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for gathering us together this morning to worship you and to give praise to you. We do desire to come into your presence. We desire to see your beauty and to behold your goodness and your kindness, Lord. And so we ask that you would meet with us. You would open our eyes and our ears to be able to hear from you this morning. You are good, and we desire to be in your presence together. We thank you for gathering us. In Jesus' name, amen.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And these are the days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore. Still we are the voice in the desert crying, behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at trumpet's call. Lift your voice, the year jubilee, out of Zion's hill salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of his servant David, building the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide in your world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Home he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at trumpet's call. Lift your voice to hear jubilee, out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at trumpet's call. Lift your voice to hear jubilee, out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
There's no God like Jehovah. 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 There's no God like Jehovah.
On the cloud, shining like the sun, at trumpet's call, lift your voice,
God in Zion till salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun at trumpet's call. Lift your voice, the year Jubilee, out of Zion till salvation comes. Out of Zion till salvation comes. Out of Zion till salvation comes. You excited this morning?
There is a river of gladness that pours from Emmanuel's veins. This sinner was plunged beneath the flood, God saved. Since then I walk in forgiveness, all of my guilt was erased. Chains of the past are broken, and last I got saved. Oh, I got saved, done by the mercy of Jesus, undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right, got a hold of my life, got Jesus, could I want more? I've received nothing but goodness. I've tested and tasted your grace. I was so lost, I fell at the cross and got saved. Oh, I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right, got a hold of my life. God, Jesus, could I want more? The love of God gave me his pardon. The love of God won't let me stay the same. The love of God pulls me up higher. His will is stronger. That's why I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. Undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. Got a hold of my life. Got Jesus. Could I want more? I've got Jesus. Could I want more? I've got Jesus. Could I want more. Good
morning. Turn in your Bibles to the book of John, chapter 4. So this is a little different for me. I don't usually read stories. I was thinking about worship, and who are we worshiping? We're worshiping the Lord, and I think it'd be really neat to just look at him. And I think a really powerful way to see him is through story, and stories are powerful. And I think that this story is incredibly powerful. So John chapter 4, and we're going to start in verse 1. And so let's just look at God's heart in this. Now when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples, he left Judea and parted again for Galilee. And he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, and was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is speaking to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, You have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock. Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water. Jesus said to her, go, call your husband and come here. The woman answered him, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you are right in saying that I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true. The woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. And Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. Just then his disciples came back, and they marveled that he was talking with a woman. But no one said, what do you seek, or why are you talking with her? So the woman left her water jar, and went away into town and said to the people, come see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ? They went out of the town and were coming to him. I don't want to get down into the weeds of the story, but just look at this story from kind of backed up a little bit, seeing the main point and what is going on here. I just think it's really neat to see this. And I think we need to understand something in order to see the point which I'm making here about their culture. So they despise Samaritans. And I think we generally know that they didn't like Samaritans, but they totally despise Samaritans. For them to say the word Samaritan, it was a dirty word. They wouldn't say that. They didn't like the Samaritans. In fact, if they were traveling to somewhere on the other side of Samaria, they wouldn't go through Samaria. They would go all the way around. So for like us going back to maybe Missouri, that would be like us going down to Florida and going all the way around just because we didn't want to go to Ohio or through Ohio or something like that. They despise Samaritans. They didn't want to have anything to do with them because of their history. And yet here is Jesus. He goes right into Samaria and he talks to this woman. And actually, this is really neat. She is the first one he tells that he is the Messiah. He goes to the one in their land who's the most in their culture, who no one would go to, and he loves her, and he's merciful and he's gracious to her. And that's the God that we serve. And you know, I think if God, you know, if he is merciful and gracious to her, someone in their day that would be the most despised and most looked down upon, you know, maybe he can love us too. And he has. He's loving and merciful and gracious, not only to her, but he's also loving, merciful, and gracious to us too. And we don't deserve a bit of it, just like this Samaritan woman didn't. So I think that's just an incredibly powerful story. And that is the God that we serve, and that is the God who saved us and redeemed us. So let's worship him together through prayer. Father, we are just so thankful for who you are. Lord, that you are merciful and gracious towards us, Lord. We don't deserve it. Lord, we just deserve your judgment, Lord. We don't deserve anything more from you. And yet you love us. Yet you care for us. Yet you're gracious to us, just as you were to the Samaritan woman. God, we don't deserve anything from you. Yet you love us. Yet you came in to die for us. And Lord, we just thank you for that, Lord. We just thank you for that, Lord. And really, Lord, all we can ever do is say thank you And so, God, we just come before you, Lord, and we just ask that, Lord, that our worship here, Lord, that it would reflect our thankful hearts for what you've done for us, God. We don't deserve a bit of it, Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Waited for this day when gathering your name, calling out to you. You're glowing like a fire, awakening desire will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're saved. We want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, your glory on your face, we're looking to the skies, descending like a cloud. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Want to see you open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see you open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
As I come into your presence, past the gates of praise, into your sanctuary, till we're standing face to face, I look upon your countenance, see the fullness of your grace, and I can only bow down and say, you are awesome in this place, mighty God,
you are awesome in this place.
I
Abba Father,
you're worthy of all praise. To you our lives we raise.
You are awesome in this place, mighty God. As I come into your presence, past the gates of praise, into your sanctuary, standing face to face, I look upon your countenance, see the fullness of your grace, and I can only bow down and say, you are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba Father. Worthy of all praise, to you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba Father. You are worthy of all praise, to you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are worthy of all praise, to you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God.
Father, we thank you for this day. You gave us the opportunity to come together again to worship you, to sing praises, Lord, to just ask that you would be with the remainder of this service, that you would prepare our hearts to hear the message that you've brought from through Pastor today. In Jesus' name, amen.
And set up. I'm looking forward to a week when we finally get back to, oh yeah, that's the way we did it last week. So I don't know about you, but workout routine has been a little bit different, okay? And thinking through, talking with some people, I know some of you are just so anxious to get back to the gym and working out, and one of my pet peeves is headlines that seem to mislead. And at first I thought I had one here. You're doing it wrong, working out. I thought, great! Oh, you don't get it, okay. You're doing it wrong, working out. You shouldn't be. No, that's really not what the article was about, okay. The article was that you needed to work out a little bit differently instead of keeping in a rut, which is unfortunate because that's what I like. So what do you do when 84-year-old shows up at Muscle Beach, right? Guy seems to be a little bit awkward and taking his time, all these guys who lift quite a bit. But he kind of takes them by surprise. Finally, that, of course, attracts the attention of one eager young man who kind of challenges him to go. He offers that the guy pick the weight, so they go at it. It looks like the guy picked a fairly easy weight. Not that I would want to lift that weight, but so the old guy tells him put 45 more pounds on, and clean and jerk, and they go up a little bit more, and he can't, and he does. So before you think, okay, I am doing the wrong workout, please understand there is something that you really should know. He's not 84 years old. They did a professional makeup job on him and dressed him just for that purpose so that he could go there and show them up. All right, so let's go to the next slide. This is actually Kenneth Leverich, who walked into a gym, and a guy challenged him to try CrossFit. He'd done all kinds of sports, and within 3 years, he was one of the top contenders in the world, just because he was a good natural athlete, good at a lot of things, and worked out. And working out is one of the things that we're going to talk about this morning. And so as we look at Philippians chapter 2, let's take a moment and pray. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity to be in your word this morning and to realize that we should work out. Lord, it's a little bit different than the physical workout, but Lord, we pray that you'd help us to think through this. To change what we're doing so that we honor and glorify you in all that we do. Be willing and ready to do what you ask us to. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. We've talked about to live is Christ, to die is gain. We've talked about humility, doing nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. All right, and this week we're into Philippians chapter 2, and verse 12 is where we're going to start. And so I ask that you follow along in God's Word. If you don't have a copy of God's Word, please holler. Let us know so that we can get you a copy of one of the greatest treasures that we have, the Word of God revealed to us so that we can understand what it is that God wants from us. Therefore, and we talked about that last week, so if you weren't here last week, you got to go back and read the first 11 verses. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Right? So don't miss the connection between the first part of the chapter and this. Paul shows that the obedience that Jesus showed and the obedience that Paul expected of Christians as followers of Jesus. This is not working for our salvation, right? That just goes in the face of everything that we read in Scripture. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, not of works, lest any man should boast. It's not working for our salvation, it's working out our salvation. Unfortunately, we are people who are ensnared by our old habits, right? Proverbs 5, 22 to 23 says this, the iniquities of the wicked ensnare him. He is held fast in the cords of his sin. He dies for lack of discipline, and because of his great folly, he is led astray. Ephesians 4, 22 and 23 talk about, you must give up your old way of life with all its bad habits. Let the Spirit change your way of thinking and make you a new person. You were created to be like God, and so you must please Him and be truly holy. Right? You're a child of God, and you're expected to reflect His character. And yet, we get ingrained, right? The way everybody else lives, the way I want to live. And we, for some reason, fail to think through that we have been saved and that God wants us to work out our salvation. Exodus talks about the fact that when God gave them the promised land, He went before them, little by little, He went before them in a gradual way, for a number of reasons, but part of it was is because He didn't want to overwhelm them, right? There was a process. God has us in a process. He has saved us, and in some ways, as we look at that in Scripture, our salvation is complete. It's finished, right? There's nothing more to be added to it. Christ died for our sins, and Christ completely paid for our salvation. Our salvation is complete in Him. Yet, God wants us to work out our salvation. He wants us to grow. 2 Corinthians, we are being transformed into that same image from one degree of glory to the next degree of glory. This comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. James 1, humbly accept the message that God has sown in your hearts and which can save your souls. Don't I beg you, only hear the message, but put it into practice. The man who looks into the perfect mirror of God's law makes a habit of so doing, puts that law into practice, and wins true happiness. So God is desiring for us to leave what's before, the old nature, to put off the old man and to put on the new man and to grow up in every way into Him. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Ephesians 4:15, speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, Christ. All right, and so we start out, we work, right? And sometimes it's just little stuff, right? Oh, I was going to start with a piece of paper, but I just figured we need to get to the point here a little bit quicker, right? And this, at one point somebody mentioned that they missed going to the gym, and Kathy offered that we had weights at home that they could lift. And I'm thinking, but, right? And then we work up, right? So that we're working more. It is a process. And I hope that you've noticed that even in your own life, as you're working through the Christian life, that the Spirit of God continues to work in you, okay? That there are things that you've noticed in the last several months that you didn't even maybe realize were a problem. Words that you use, attitudes that you display, reactions that you make. Because that is part of the Christian life. That's part of how we should know, that God is at work in us. Because that's the good news, right? It's not just that we're working out our salvation. God tells us here in the next verse, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do His good pleasure. Do you remember back Philippians chapter 1, verse 6? It said, I'm confident of this very thing, that He who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Jesus Christ. Right? God isn't done with us. He is continuing to perfect, to mature, to make us more. Right? And He's providing the power. Right? I don't know about you. I've tried to do several things with the power unplugged. My power saw does not work very well that way. It takes a long time to cut through something. Right? We've had equipment, and we're trying to figure out what's not working, and sure enough, it's a connection. Power isn't in, or it's not plugged into the computer, it's, right? God has promised that He is at work in us, that His Spirit is at work in us to help us to grow. That we don't have to depend upon ourselves. We're involved in it. We have to make every effort. Scripture talks about that as well. So it's not like it's a passive thing. Oh, well, God's gonna. If God wants me to stop using these words, stop this attitude, then He'll make me. Well, I don't know that I'd challenge God to that, because He just might take you up on it. But that's not the relationship that Scripture reveals to us, right? God convicts us and expects us to respond to when he says, look, you really shouldn't have said that. That you repent. It may mean you need to go up to somebody and say, hey, I'm sorry. That was thoughtless. That was sinful. That was could have been done better. I should have done better. All right? The Spirit of God at work within us both to will and to do his good pleasure. That's awesome. You probably have had no children like my children, where I've had to force them to do something for my good pleasure. All right? Because, you see, that's not what that verse says. The verse says that God is at work in us both to will and to do. We desire to do. Right? And I hope that you've seen it as well in your children. But I know my parents finally saw it in me eventually. Right? That the things that they taught me that were good, that eventually I started to do because I realized they were good. I don't know at what age kids finally learn that picking up and keeping the house neat. I wish I could tell you. I wish I could tell you. But there does come a point, it seems, that for a lot of them, that all of a sudden they realize, wow, you know, if I don't just lay everything around the house, I'll be able to find it, right, within 45 minutes. If I keep it clean, then mom doesn't have to make me clean up everything, right? But there comes a point at which it becomes, you know, I desire. I can't tell you how many times my mom told me, you need to go clean up your room. And now I don't have a problem with keeping my room clean. It seems easier. What is that? That it's the same thing. God working in us to will and to do his good pleasure. So if we're having a problem with, well, you know, I just really don't want to do what God says, then we have a problem, right? Because God says that as a believer, he's working in us to do his good pleasure. So, all right, have we beat this horse enough? All right, because 2 months ago, this is what brought us to Philippians, all right? Do everything without complaining or arguing, murmuring and disputing, all right? It's pretty plain, right? We just need to ask God to continue to work in us, right? To work on our hearts. And for those of you complaining that there are times when you must disagree, I'll agree with that, okay? I agree that there are times when we should disagree. Scripture's full of that as well. I think where complaining and arguing comes in. In this chapter, if you think about it, what did we talk about last week? Attitude precedes action, right? And Paul and Christ are reminding us, and Christ gives us the example. His attitude is to humble himself and to serve, and from that comes his actions. And so maybe the words out of your mouth are right. But is the heart attitude behind them correct? Right? Again, my mother, very wise woman, you know, she used to say that as well. Watch your tone. Boy, you better be careful how you speak to me. Your dad's coming home. Right? Our heart attitude. How do we think through it? So we hit that one pretty hard. Let's go to Philippians 2:15. Because part of the reason why God wants us to be careful with the words that we say and the attitude of our heart is because he wants us to be blameless and harmless, children of God without fault. So that no one can look at us and blame us and say, hey, wow, they're just not following after Jesus. Harmless has the thought of pure or unalloyed. It's blameless and harmless. The Greek word could even be translated hornless, without a horn. So what you're looking at is that we're to be creatures not only that do no harm, but could not do any harm. Like sheep that not only will not devour, but cannot devour. Because it's contrary to their nature. Right? be harmless, blameless. Matthew 10:16 says, "Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves." Romans 16:19, "For your obedience is come abroad unto all men. I'm glad therefore on your behalf. But yet I would have you wise unto that which is good and simple concerning evil." Harmless concerning evil. Even ignorant of evil, right? That you're not putting, you're not even that knowledgeable of what would be evil. Now, that would seem to be easier to do here at church, right? I mean, that we would hope that the peer pressure would be that we would be blameless and harmless, that we'd do all things without murmuring and complaining, and that others would be able to say, "Oh, wow, this is great." But that's really not the place that Paul says, this is where I need you, this is where God needs you, this is where God wants you to be doing all things without murmuring and complaining. He does want it done in the church, but what he really says is, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation among whom you shine as lights in the world. Right? So this is the crooked forest. They really don't know why it's that way. They all go up, turn 90 degrees, and then are let to grow up naturally. One theory is that it happened because of a major snowstorm. The other thought is that somebody actually did that, but they do not know what caused it. It's become quite a tourist attraction, right? The word is that's used in our scripture is to turn aside from the right path, right? Our culture, our generation, is wicked and perverse, and they have turned aside from the right path. Just another reason why we wouldn't want to follow them. We're to shine as lights in the world. In a dark place, we're to be very visible. Why? Because we're holding fast the word of life. We are displaying God's word. We're revealing it. We're making it known. We treasure God's word because it's our instruction, right? As a matter of fact, we have a program where we emphasize quite a bit the memorization of God's word. And this morning, we'd like to take a moment and recognize those who are receiving awards for memorizing God's word. Pastor Brandon's going to come. I'm going to grab a camera.
The last time Awana was able to meet was, I think, March 11th. And so it's been a different type of Awana year. We haven't been able to have a Awana closing program. So we're going to seek to recognize those who have been learning God's word. We know that the word of the Lord endures forever. Okay, we talk about youth being the future, and that's true. But even the youth do not endure forever. But those in whom the word of the Lord dwells endure forever. And so we want to recognize them. We want to celebrate them. And so I'm going to ask for our directors to come up to be able to hand out the awards. When we call your name, we're going to ask you to come up, and the director, appropriate director, or one of our filling in the cubbies are over there. I'll start with those certificates. So we're going to start with the cubbies, who are our youngest. That was led by Carrie Spiller. She was the director for the Cubbies. And we want to recognize first Jackson Mullen for receiving her certificate. Come on up. And Piper Slayton also received a certificate. Piper's not shy. And also Hudson Mitchell, Miles Mitchell, Carolyn Slayton also earned certificates for Cubbies this year. For the Cubbies Appleseed Award and a parent diploma, really is very appropriate this year because parents were deeply involved in Awana throughout the end of the year. Leah Cole earned her golden apple, and I think Levi and Rachel helped her with that. So. I think so. Good job, Leah. And then for the Sparks certificate, Sparks are kindergarten, first grader, and second grader. Let's see, I'm trying to read through the ones who are here first. Lacey Slayton has earned her Sparks certificate, as have McKenna Cartwright, Gideon Cook, Audrey Hall, Addison Hall, Leticia Hernandez, Maggie Hubbard, Clayton Knoll, Jace Landis, Emmett Obrachta, Braylon Owens, Richard Plummer, Rylan Prouty, and Kayla Spears all have earned their Sparks certificates. For the kindergartners who earned their Hang Glider Award, which is the first book in the Sparks, Elizabeth Cole earned her Hang Glider Award. She also did the Hang Glider Review, which is basically going back through the whole book. Colby Mullen earned his Hang Glider Award. And Benjamin Tietze earned his Hang Glider Award, too. Ben did the review as well as the Hang Glider Frequent Flyer, which is an additional book. And then Zeb Sanford, Bennett Shoemaker, Addie Sullivan also earned their their Hang Glider Awards for kindergartners. For first graders who earned their Hang Glider Award, Coralie Mitchell and Leah Shoemaker. For the Wing Runner Award in first grade, Kayla Devine, her Wing Runner Review, Wing Runner Frequent Flyer. And she did a TNT book too, in addition to all that. Levi Sullivan earned his Wing Runner Award, as did Noah Tietze, along with the Wing Runner Review and the Wing Runner Frequent Flyer. And for second grade, our Wing Runner Award recipient earned it, Owen Mullen. Congratulations, Owen. For TNT, the third through sixth graders who have received certificates this year, Olivia Mullen has received her certificate. And let me read the others as well. Kendall Baker, Madison Baker, Evelyn Barkley, Gabriel Barkley, Abigail Bennett, Mariana Bollinger, Ben Burleson, Jacob Coots, Miley Curry, Kylie Dennis, Andrew Hagedone, Nicholas Hernandez, Hayden Hubbard, Caden Johnson, Wyatt Landis, Dennis Lasnik, Kendall Najati, always messes me up, Bentley Obrachta, Trinity Obrachta, Isabella Plummer, Quinn Royce, Evie Slayton has earned her certificate. And then also Madeline Slayton, Carlton Slayton, Devin Tremper, Adrian Tremper, Jordan Tyler, Grace Van Gorder, and Sonny Wilson. For the 24-7 certificates, we have Kendra Gay, we have Sarah Hayes, Isaac McFeeters. You can come, Isaac. And then we have Ayla Mead and Sam Patterson. Yep, right there. And then for the, wrong page here. For our Sparky plaques, these are Sparks who have done all three books in the Sparks section of Awana. Aria Gardner has earned her Sparky plaque. She also did the Sky Stormer Review and the Sky Stormer Frequent Flyer, in addition to her book. Eric Rittenauer, I don't believe he's here, he did all three books this year. This is his first year of doing Awana. He did all three books in addition to the Sky Stormer Review, which is the third book review. He's just an awesome Sparky this year. And then McKinley Slayton also earns her Sparky plaque this year, doing the Sky Stormer book and the Sky Stormer Review. Then this is the Alpha Award, first book award for the TNTers. Cooper Gardner earned his Alpha Award this year. Daniel Cole earned his Alpha Award. He also did all the silver sections. Seth Marvin earned his Alpha Award. Shane Rittenauer earned his Alpha Award. He also completed the silver and the gold sections in the book. The gold, every gold section is essentially five or six verses that he completed. Did great work. Kate Shoemaker, Anna Shoemaker, and then Lily Slayton also earned her Alpha Award. The Excellence Award, this is two books in third grade and on. Michael Cole earns his Excellence Award this year. Congratulations. And then Micah Molin also earns his Excellence Award. Having completed the silver sections as well, Evan Obrachta earned his award with the silver, and Daytona Smith. The Challenge Award is three books having completed. Charlie Spiller earned his Challenge Award, did the silver sections. Madison Van Gorder as well. And then for the Timothy Award, this is four books in the TNT. Micah Marvin earned the Timothy Award with the silver sections. And Marlena Payne also earned her Timothy Award. We don't have her award right now, but we'll get it to her tomorrow. But it is awesome to see that, recognize that learning and memorizing God's word isn't something that we do simply when we're young. It's something that we can do all of our lives, to put it in God's word. Okay. Great way to give an offhanded insult, huh? You guys know what I'm talking about. And then our last award for this morning, having completed 10 books from all the way from third grade to as a senior, is Rachel Eckler earning the Citation Award. This is a big, big deal. So congratulations. Those who participated in Awana this year who haven't been able to be here, we're going to meet on Wednesday at 3:30 here at the church, and we're going to drive around delivering the rest of the awards. You are welcome to join us. Just let us know so we can kind of plan on how large our caravan is going to be. Thank you for investing in Awana. Thank you for those of you who've served and given of your time to help mentor other children, or mentor children to know God's word, for it to be in our hearts deeply, so that the word of the Lord may dwell forever. Thank you all.
Oh, yep, that was the slide I was supposed to put up, Isaac, sorry. So the bags are for those who did the Awana work at home, because it's a little bit of a challenge this year, getting done with our Awana program. I would encourage you, the Word of God lasts forever. It says that we're to hold fast the Word of life, and hopefully you realize that probably the most impactful, maybe that's not quite the right way to say this, is that if someone came up to us, we would know how to share the word of life, right? The word of God that takes us from death to life. Now, our Awana kids, they get it drilled into them over and over again. The Awana leaders learn it by almost osmosis, right? Because they've gone through it so many times. But I trust that you would know, if God would give you the opportunity, how you would hold forth the word of life. If you met someone this week, or you know someone this week, what would you tell them? What verse would you share with them that would talk about the dark color, the problem that we have? The problem that we have is what? Sin, right? It separates us from God. What verse in Scripture talks to us about that. John 3:23. No, John 3:16. Romans 3:23. What is Romans 3:23? Right. We could also use Romans 3:10-11. All have sinned. You know, there's none righteous, no, not one. All right. What is the solution to the fact that they're sinners? What's the solution to the fact that they're sinners? The blood, right? The blood of Jesus Christ is the cure, right? So what verse do we know? What verse can we share? Okay. Maybe we ought to work on those, right? Christ died for us, right? While Romans 5:8, right? While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. His death was necessary. All right, so what happens after we accept Christ as our Savior? We are made right, right? We're cleansed, we're clean, and we don't have to worry about the payment for that sin because Christ has paid that penalty for our sin. All right, do we have verses that tell us about our cleanness, our being forgiven? 1 John 1:9. That's our sins. Right. I understand that very problem. If you just tell me a reference, at least give me the first word, right? yeah, because we have a lot of Awana kids that are doing the same thing. That we can be clean, right? We can have a new life. And do we have a responsibility after we're clean? Does God tell us that we're supposed to do anything? Or is that the end? Okay, so we should share, right? We just grow, right? We've got to grow. The next color in the Wordless Book series is green, that we're supposed to grow. Know any verses that would talk about that? This is one where John 3:16 doesn't hit so hard. Okay, we are new creatures, right? We've talked about in Peter, grow in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, right? And so what we're supposed to do is we're supposed to continue to grow. Is that the end of the journey? No, right? Because we want to make sure that they understand that the purpose for the Word of Life, the purpose is that our sins would be forgiven, that we would have abundant life here, right? We would grow, but that there is more, right? It's not just abundant life that we have. It's eternal life that we have. We have a future in heaven, right? Scripture talks about streets made of gold. Scripture talks about there being no more sorrow, no more death, right? That we can look forward. We have life eternal with our God and our Savior. Do you got that down? Do you have a way to hold fast and to hold forth the Word of Life? I hope so, right? You don't necessarily have to memorize a whole Awana book, although that's not a bad idea. But you need to know God's Word well enough that you can share it, because that's our purpose, right? We don't grumble and complain so that we have, that we shine as light so that people realize, wow, he's different. But the reason why we're different is to share the Word of Life. But if we don't know it, how can we say we're holding fast to it? Right? Is it precious to you? Is it precious to you that you have salvation? Again, there's a hard attitude that God needs to work on if it's not. Paul goes on to talk about so that he can rejoice when he sees that the seed that he's planted, the Word of Life that he shared with the Philippians, brings forth fruit, when their reward is evident and obvious, that they can say, wow, look, I didn't waste it. I didn't waste the time. The Lord has worked in them. He's grown them just as he said he would, and I haven't labored in vain. Paul then says, yes, and if I am being poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. For the same reason, you also be glad and rejoice with me. Right? Scripture talks about the fact that we are to give our all. Okay, the drink offering was poured out on top of the meat offering. Right? And it was a symbol. You didn't just pour half of it. You poured it all. And Paul says, look, I'm committed to giving it all. Right? And again, one of the things I'm finding is that this isn't something that I did when I was 6, when I did when I was 13, when I did as a senior in high school. Those are definite times that I can go back and I can say, God, I give you everything. It's yours. But you know what I find? Is I find that yesterday, this morning, I had to remind myself, I am being poured out as a drink offering, and God, I am willing to do it. Thank you for working in me to make me will and to do for your good pleasure. Because it ultimately be for my good as well, right? Paul then says, he gives two examples. And Timothy, he brings up, Timothy has a Gentile father, a Jewish mother and grandmother. He grows up knowing the scriptures. Right? It's one of the reasons why we have a Timothy Award, because it just reflects a young man who has committed his life to serving the Lord. And Paul says, now, I want you to notice a couple of words, and I'm hoping that it's like, oh yeah, I remember we talked about those words just last week again. Paul says Timothy is like-minded, right? We're to have the mind of Christ, right? I want you to be of one mind. And he says, look, Timothy is an example of this very thing. He is like-minded. He's determined to follow after the Lord. And then it also says, for all seek their own, not the things which are of Christ. I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly, that I also may be encouraged when I know your state. For I have no one like-minded who will sincerely care for your state. All seek their own, not the things which are of Christ. That's what we talked about last week, right? That we get selfish, and Timothy bears us out. Right, he puts the needs of others. He goes, he serves where Paul puts him. He becomes the leader of the church in Ephesus and teaching them. But you know his proven character, that as a son with his father, he served with me in the gospel. Therefore, I hope to send him at once, as soon as I see how it goes with me. I trust in the Lord that I myself will come shortly. And then he gives the example of Epaphroditus, which we did talk about 2 months ago, okay? And I put the dice on there. Hopefully that like triggers a thought, right? Because what Paul says of Epaphroditus is this. I consider it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother, fellow worker, and fellow soldier, but your messenger, the one who ministered to my need, since he was longing for you all, was distressed because you had heard that he was sick. For indeed he was sick, almost unto death, but God had mercy on him, not only in him, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore, I sent him the more eagerly, that when you see him again, you may rejoice. I may be less sorrowful. Receive him, therefore, in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such men in esteem. Because for the work of Christ, he came close to death, not regarding his life, to supply what was lacking in your service toward me. Not regarding his life. The phrase there is to roll the dice, to roll it all, to commit. This is it. I'm all in. It's all or nothing. I'm choosing to serve God regardless of the cost. And if you remember, particularly 2 months ago, we talked about the fact that Epaphroditus became the model of those who would go into those with the plague. spending their lives without thought, because they knew that they were doing what was right. Will we choose to serve in that same way? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity we've had to look at your word. We thank you for the opportunity we've had to recognize those who've taken time this year to memorize God's word. Lord, may that be a challenge to each of us. And Lord, may we hold fast the word of life. May we choose to know that word so that we can share that word. And then, Lord, I pray that you would put in each and every one of our paths this week someone that we can share the good news of life. Life eternal, life abundant, life free this week. May that ever be on our heart. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you for coming this morning. I do just want to run through a few things quickly. If you haven't given us your email, if you're not reading your email, shame on you. It's happening. It's happening. 12 hours before we set the deadline, we actually figured almost 24 hours. Actually, we got, and we are going to have VBS. It's going to be different, okay? And some of the details are on our website. We would ask that you register. We're up to, 21 this morning? 21. Already registered, and we're limited, so invite people. One of the greatest things for me is there's at least six or seven there who are not normally coming to our church, the 21 already. So that win! We won, right? that's the way we look at it. We won already. But pray that things would work through well. There's just so many details there. All right. The Awana Awards drop off. Pastor Brandon mentioned.
If they didn't get their stay at home
prize, meet up. Oh, okay. Yes. If for some reason we didn't get you the work at home treat bag, come up and see Pastor Brandon. He'll get it for you. Okay. Wednesday prayer meeting. If you haven't signed up for hospitality for Eli and Sadie, please do that. The summer fellowship groups. There's 80 some people who've are participating in that. If you are not yet in one of those groups, please let us know. Pastor Brandon would like to get you signed up for that. Dads lead Sunday school, and then we have Zoom for youth group tonight. Thank you for coming. If you would, put on your masks, and you can fellowship in here for a little while. There are other things going on in the building, so